Okay, we're going to be in Genesis chapter 41. Genesis 41, we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 36 this morning. And let's pray again before we jump into God's word. Lord, thank you so much for your word. It is a lamp. It is a light. It is our encouragement and our strength, and it builds us up. And we are so grateful. And we ask that as we're in your word this morning, that you would just speak to our hearts in a way that only you can do, and that you would take the words from the pages of your word and that you would plant them in our heart, and that seed would just produce fruit in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so picking it up from last week, we left Joseph in where? What was he? In prison. In the pit. Yeah, we saw it was even a pit. And yet he was in charge now in the prison. And he'd taken care of two very special political prisoners. Do you remember who they were? The cupbearer and the baker for the Pharaoh, yes. And very high-ranking officers. And so a very interesting thing happened while they were there in the prison. What happened for them? Yes, God gave them dreams. And then what happened after that? Because there was nobody to interpret, right? The professional dream interpreters, apparently none of them had been imprisoned lately. So how did that all happen? What happens next? God gave Joseph. Yeah, and remember Joseph said, I'm not the one who can interpret your dreams, but God, the God, the God. And the article, the, is used in the Hebrew. The God. Instead of all these gods of Egypt, the one and only true creator, omnipotent, overall God. He's the one who can tell you what these dreams mean. And so God gave Joseph the interpretation. It was in 3 days. Their heads would be lifted up. The chief cupbearer, his head would be lifted up, and he'd be reinstated to his position. So instead of his head bowed down in sorrow, his head is lifted up in joy. The other one, his head is lifted up from off his body. And so he was beheaded. And that's where it ends. And Joseph says now to the cupbearer, please remember me. But what happened? Nope. Yeah, he forgot him. He completely put him out of his mind. He didn't even pay any attention. He is back there at his job, and it is 2 more years. We read that in chapter 41, verse 1. It says, after 2 whole years. You know, it would be enough to say 2 years, but the Hebrew actually says 2 whole years. It's really emphasizing. This is a long time. And Joseph has been stuck here in this prison now 13 years at this point. And there was nobody to advocate for him. The only person who could get him out of prison would be Pharaoh. And there's no hope of that now. It's been 2 years. Joseph's figured out, yeah, he's not going to talk about me. He's not going to mention me. So Joseph just kind of, you know, dug in and realized, I'm going to be here the rest of my life. So I'm just going to live for God here in the prison the rest of my life. And God was using that experience to just work on Joseph. So Joseph is not forgotten, though, because we've already seen in chapter 40, the Lord was what? With Joseph. The Lord was with Joseph. And not just his presence, but the Lord, the covenant-keeping Yahweh God, is not only with us, but he's working in us, and he's going to work through us to accomplish something for his eternal purposes. God was doing a work in Joseph's life. On the human side, it seemed to be ingratitude that the cupbearer hadn't happened to mention Joseph. But from God's perspective and plan, it just wasn't the right time yet. There was a special time. And God's doing a work in Joseph's life. What was God doing? He was testing Joseph. Now, do you remember when you were in school and you had to take tests? How many of you, like, you would know the subject, you would know it, but as soon as that test was in front of you, your mind would go blank? Yeah, don't be afraid to raise your hands. See, you thought you were the only one. It's almost half the group feels this way. It's not uncommon. It's test anxiety. And in life, you know, we go through these tests, and sometimes I have test anxiety as I'm going through tests in life. Not the academic kind, but the life variety kind. I get anxious. I wake up and I have a hard time sleeping at night. I'm worrying. I'm upset. It's like, it's hard to go through tests, isn't it? And that test anxiety isn't just academic. It can be life. But God is doing a work when he allows us. And even it's even more than just allow, because that just sounds like God's kind of weak and everybody else jerks us around. It's not just allow. God does more than allow. It can be his will. As our apostle says, the Lord may will that you suffer for a little while. It can be God's will that we go through suffering, not because he's mean and cruel, but because that is doing something very specific in our life that nothing else can do. Nothing else can do that. So God is testing Joseph, and God remembers him. Psalm 105, go ahead and turn there. We keep going to Psalm 105, 18 and 19. And this, we're going to read the end of verse 19. So Psalm 105, verses 18 and 19, this inspired, God-given commentary on Joseph's experience in prison, because it doesn't tell us much in the Genesis account. It just says he did it, but it doesn't say some of the stuff that was going on. So Psalm 105, verse 18, it says, his feet were hurt with fetters, his neck was put in a collar of iron, until what he had said came to pass, the word of the Lord did what? Tested him. So there's a purpose in these 13 years. There's a purpose in these 2 years of being forgotten and abandoned in prison. That purpose is testing. And that word for testing means to fuse metal. In other words, it's like a welder. You know, the sparks are flying and he's welding these pieces of metal and melting them, literally melting it together. It means to purge or to purify or to try or to refine. Like you take the ore and you crush it and then you heat it up until the ore melts and all the impurities come to the surface and the true ore, the true metal, the gold or the silver or whatever is left and it's purified. That's testing. It involves fire. It involves crushing. Have you experienced God's testing in your life? Probably all of us. And if you haven't, you will. It's just a part of how God takes a very imperfect, painful world, but makes something beautiful out of that. You know, A.W. Tozier said, it is necessary for God to use the hammer, the fire, and the furnace in his holy work of preparing a saint for true sainthood. It is doubtful whether God can bless a person greatly until he has hurt them deeply. Let me read that last part. It is doubtful whether God can bless a person greatly until he has hurt them deeply. And you just look at the great people in the Bible. They all went through great pain in their lives. So if you're going through great pain, be encouraged. You're one of God's great people. You're like, I'd like to be great without the pain. That's the point. We can't be great without the pain. But there's a limit. What we just read in Psalm 105:19, it says, the word of the Lord tested him, but it says, until. Aren't you glad that word until is there? It means that the pain doesn't go on forever. I'm not going to stay here forever in this painful circumstance or situation or relationship or whatever it is. It has a time limit until. And for Joseph, it was 2 years. I like what Donald Gray Barnhouse says. He says, not only your steps, but your stops are ordered by the Lord. Not only your steps, you know, like walking with the Lord, not only your steps, but your stops are ordered by him. I just think that's so encouraging. So there's times when life just comes to a screeching halt and you're stuck in this thing. That's ordered by God. as well as those times that you're progressing and moving and walking with the Lord. So Genesis 41:1, after 2 whole years, this probably brings us around the time of Pharaoh's birthday again, right? Because the whole thing with the butler and the baker was in 3 days, which was Pharaoh's birthday. They would be taken out of prison, and then the things that would happen according to their dreams would happen. So 2 whole years from that, probably around Pharaoh's birthday. So after 2 whole years, Pharaoh dreamed, now we're with Pharaoh. Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing by the Nile. And behold, there came up out of the Nile 7 cows, attractive and plump. I just have to stop right there. I love how the Bible puts plump with attractive. Let's just see that as God's big hug from him to all of us today. Plump is the new attractive, okay? So there came up 7 cows. I'm not a cow, but I'm just saying. Attractive and plump, and they fed in the reed grass. And behold, 7 other cows, ugly and thin, came up out of the Nile after them and stood by the other cows on the bank of the Nile. And the ugly, thin cows ate up the 7 attractive, plump cows. And Pharaoh awoke. And he fell asleep and dreamed a second time. And behold, 7 ears of grain, plump and good, were growing on one stalk. And behold, after them sprouted 7 ears, thin and blighted by the east wind. And the thin ears swallowed up the 7 plump, full ears. And Pharaoh awoke, and behold, it was a dream. I think that's interesting. He awoke and, oh, it's a dream. It seemed so real. That's the point that's being made here. So Pharaoh has 2 dreams in succession. This emphasizes the significance of these dreams. Dream number one, the Pharaoh, he's standing by the Nile. Now, the Nile, that is the source of life for all of Egypt, even today. I mean, Egypt is a vast wasteland desert. That's what it is, except it has the Nile going from south to north, running the entire length of the country. And so basically, most of the population of Egypt, it lives all along the Nile. All in the ancient times, little villages and the smaller little cities, they were all along the Nile. In modern times, everything is basically all along the Nile, because that's where you're going to get the water that you need when you live in a desert. That's how you're going to grow food when you're in a desert. But the awesome thing about the Nile is that it's pretty consistent. From antiquity, the Nile's pretty consistent. It generally is always running. And it generally does what it does until modern times with dams. But what the Nile would do, there were certain seasons that the Nile would flood. And so you'd use that as irrigation. We know about that here in Phoenix, don't we? In fact, if you live in some of the older neighborhoods, that's how you water your yard, isn't it? Flood irrigation. Your yard is dug a little lower, and every so often, the water just comes, that you receive, just instead of sprinklers or drip systems, it just floods your whole yard. And then it seeps down into the ground. And that's how they grew things in Egypt for thousands of years. In fact, even today. But they don't generally have the Nile flooding. They control the Nile more with dams and that sort of thing now, and use irrigation systems. But in ancient times, the Nile, you could count on it. Man, it's such and such a time of year, it's going to flood. It would flood and flood all your fields, and then the waters would subside, and you would be able to grow all sorts of stuff. That's why from antiquity, Egypt was like the breadbasket of the Middle East, of the ancient world, even of Europe. I mean, even in the time of the New Testament, the Romans, I mean, Egypt, people go to Egypt and they'd load up on all the grain that you'd get in Egypt. What do we love that comes from Egypt? Egyptian cotton sheets. Is there anything better, right? Okay, so it's still known as this huge agricultural area, and it is a bleak desert. But it's because of the Nile River. That's why, To the Egyptians, the Nile was such a symbol of life. And the Egyptians, being the polytheists that they were from ancient times, they believed that everything, you know, that did something good for them, and even stuff that did bad stuff, was a god. And so the river was a god. The Pharaoh was a god. The dung beetle was a god. Cows were gods. Everything was gods. That's why later than Joseph, when we have Moses 450 years later, and we have the plagues of Egypt, that's not only God making Pharaoh uncomfortable, that's the true and living God judging the gods of Egypt. As you go through those plagues, those are all Egyptian gods that go wacko, because God, the true God, is the only God. And so the Egyptians, they worshipped all these different gods. They worshipped Pharaoh. They worshipped the Nile. So here's the God Pharaoh, supposedly, standing by the God Nile River, the source of all the food and their life and their supply and everything they need, and a very consistent thing. It wasn't common for the river not to do what it normally did. And so what Pharaoh sees are these seven attractive, plump cows coming up out of the river, and they're just kind of standing in the marshy areas, feeding on the marshy grasses that are growing there. And cows were worshipped as gods too, because they provided life. You know, there was meat, there was milk, there was, you know, you can make things from the milk. So cows were worshipped. In fact, the cow was the emblem of Isis, which was I-S-I-S, not Isis like you're thinking right now, the goddess Isis, who was revered as the Egyptian goddess of fertility. The god of vegetation in the netherworld, Osiris, was represented as a great bull accompanied by seven cows. So we have Isis, Osiris, there's these plays, and that's why I'm bringing this up, because to Pharaoh, as an Egyptian, he's God, the Nile god, Isis, represented by the cows, and he's thinking of Osiris, who's the bull god, but is always accompanied by how many cows? Seven cows. And so we have, you know, this triunity, you know, triple gods going on here, okay? That's what's happening, and it's worship. But something horrible happens. The gods are attacked. They're attacked because seven ugly, thin, you know, scrawny cows come up out of the Nile, which is really weird because the Nile's a source of life. So how is it bringing forth something so ghastly and looking emaciated and ready to die? So these seven ugly, thin cows come up. And then, you know, cows are vegan. But these cows become cannibalistic. And they attack the other cows. And it says they literally chew them. They consume them. They start biting and devouring them until the beautiful fat cows are all gone by these ugly, scrawny, skinny cows. And Pharaoh, he's a god, and he can't stop it from happening. The Nile's a god, and it's the one who's brought forth these horrible cows. I mean, what's happened to Isis and Osiris? I mean, is there any help from any gods here? No. They are all debased. Nobody can do anything. And this is so shocking that Pharaoh is startled out of his sleep. And his heart is pounding, I'm sure. I mean, really, a nice, beautiful cow with its beautiful big brown eyes becomes cannibalistic? I mean, that's freaky. This is like a horror dream. You know, like going to a horror movie or something. Ugh, it's horrible. But then eventually he falls back asleep again, and he has a second dream. Seven plump ears of grain are growing on one stalk. Now, you may think corn, because you hear ears of grain. There was no corn in ancient Egypt. That's a New World thing from the Americas. So no corn. It's talking about grain, and it's saying plump, you know, grains on this stalk of grain. Egypt was known for growing grain, so wheat, barley, rye, you know, all these different grains. Very prolific in Egypt was the breadbasket of the world. So it's not talking about corn. And even some translations say corn, and okay, oh well, but it's not corn because they didn't have corn. So there's no mention of the Nile, though, in this second dream. Why? Because this is in the fields. These are the agricultural fields that the Nile would flood, and these are the grain, the crops that are growing. So we have this stalk that grows up, and it's just got the best grain. I mean, the grains are huge and plump, and it's just loaded with all of this. And then a second stalk sprouts up just as quickly, like immediately. And the grain on that stalk, they're blighted and they're thin, they're hard. It's a very inferior thing. And it says they were blighted by the east wind. East of the Nile, the eastern part, the western part as well, but east of the Nile, we have the eastern deserts of Egypt. Then from there, we have the Red Sea, and then on the other side of that, we have the Sinai. And so any winds coming from the east, they're blasting across desolate desert, and it's hot. And it's fierce, the winds that can stir up in a desert. We know how fierce those winds can be, the dust storms that can happen in a desert. And so you can imagine, it's easy for us in Phoenix to imagine this east wind and this huge, hot, horrific wind coming. And it's like a haboob. You can see the wall of dust approaching. And it has destroyed these crops. They're just withered, and it's horrible. And once again, an unnatural, creepy thing happens. These blighted grains swallow up. Now, here it doesn't say they chew them. It says like they swallow them whole. Think like a snake, how a snake opens its jaws and dislocates them and swallows prey that's even bigger than its mouth. And then you see the lump going down the body as the muscles move that prey down to the stomach. Can you tell I'm a homeschool teacher? Sorry, I always get the grossology going here. Oh, well, it's me. But anyway, so, you know, that's what these grains do. They literally swallow the other grain whole. They're not chewing like the cows did. And so, once again, this is creepy. Plants don't eat other plants generally. Generally. There are a few of those like Venus flytrap, but it's not eating plants, it's eating bugs. Have you ever gotten one of those with your kids? And then you put a little fly on it and watch it clamp down. Yeah, that's very interesting. It's like creepy meat-eating plants. Ew. You know? But these plants are creepy. It's unnatural behavior, and it's cannibalistic in a different kind of sense because it's plant attacking plant. And so once again, Pharaoh wakes up. I mean, it's just like, oh, and it's a dream. It was so real. Now, verse 8, so in the morning, his spirit was troubled, I guess. If you'd just had two horror dreams, you'd be pretty troubled in the morning, wouldn't you? And he sent and called for all the magicians of Egypt and all its wise men. Now, that's what stuck out to me this time as I was reading it. He didn't just call for magicians and wise men. How many? All of them. It's repeated twice. So, you know, of course, there were a lot of magicians and wise men, and these are two different classes. One would include, like, the enchantment, spell casting, reading omens type, the magician kind, and the other would be the wise men, and those would be, like, the counselors, and I'm sure involved in that, too, were the professional dream interpreters in that enchantment magician kind of class. And so, but it's not just all the ones that might have been there in the local area. It's all of them that are throughout the entire land of Egypt. So as I was reading this, it really struck me, this took a while to get the message to everybody. I mean, he's at basically like the area of Memphis, but he has to send people to Thebes because, and that's quite a distance by river. He has to send, you know, messengers to Thebes because that's where there's a lot of temples and you're going to have a lot of magicians and wise men around that area and various other parts of the country. And it's a pretty large country, and in ancient times, it's not like, you know, you could send an email or a text message. So this takes a while. Sometimes we lose the sense of how long things can go in the Bible. And this took a while to get that message, but they all rush there. You know, if the king calls you, you drop everything and you go. So eventually, all of the magicians and all of the wise men throughout all of Egypt gather, and Pharaoh told them his dreams. But there was none who could interpret them to Pharaoh. Okay, he has just brought in all the professionals and the entire brain trust of Egypt. And nobody can tell him what his dreams mean. Now, it's very interesting that he's even asking for an interpretation, because remember, who is he supposed to be? God. Pharaoh was considered God. It was like he was the connection between the Egyptian people and all the gods. And so if the gods had something to say, Pharaoh would be the messenger. He would be the one that would interpret that in Egyptian belief. And so he would be the one to receive that message from the gods and be able to give it to the people. Okay, so God Pharaoh is not doing a very good job, is he? Because obviously the gods have sent him a message where the gods themselves aren't doing their jobs, and God Pharaoh can't figure out what the gods are saying, so he has to ask all the professionals. I mean, this is really humiliating in one sense, isn't it? And we just see how God is just setting everything up to show this Pharaoh and all of Egypt that there is only one God, one true and living God. So he's troubled. He's agitated. That word, when it says he woke up, he was troubled, it means to beat persistently. So it could be like his heart was beating out of his chest. He's like in panic attack mode going on right there. He's supposed to be a God. Why can't he understand this? Why is he having these horrible dreams where there's cannibalism going on, and the gods and even himself, they're standing there, they're helpless, they can't do anything about it. I mean, it is frightening. And then he gets everybody there and no one can tell him what this dream means. And so what's going to happen? It's hopeless, isn't it? Then verse 9. Then, do you see the importance of these transition words? Why was Joseph in the prison for 2 more years? Because there's a then. There's a moment. If that cupbearer had said something prior to then, it might have just gone right over Pharaoh's head. But when Pharaoh is desperate, he knows this is a message from the gods, and he knows that the gods are falling, including himself. And horrible stuff. There's something horrible that's supposed to happen. And nobody can interpret it. At that moment, then the cupbearer, God moves the cupbearer to remember Joseph. See, God has it all worked out. He has it all worked out. So your suffering is not endless. It's just not time yet. And so then, verse 9 says, the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, I remember my offenses today. Notice he says offenses, plural. He was thrown into prison for an offense he committed against Pharaoh, which is another way to translate that is sin, an offense, which they found out he wasn't the one who did it, it was the baker. But he's assuming that the offense of Pharaoh. What's this other offense? Because it's plural. He hadn't said anything about Joseph. So it's a sin against Pharaoh that he had been suspected of. It's a sin against Joseph because he'd completely forgotten Joseph. So I remember my offenses today. When Pharaoh was angry with his servants and put me and the chief baker in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, we dreamed on the same night, he and I, each having a dream with its own interpretation. A young Hebrew was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard. I just have to stop and say, Joseph's in his 30s, and how is he described? Young. I have a 27-year-old daughter who thinks she's getting old. I can't wait to show this to her. A young Hebrew in his 30s. I think 30s are young, was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard. When we told him, he interpreted our dreams to us. Now, wait, who's he giving the credit for the interpretation? Joseph. What had Joseph told him in prison? That God. Okay, so obviously he didn't get that point, okay? But, okay, so he interpreted our dreams to us, giving an interpretation to each man according to his dream. And as he interpreted to us, so it came about. I was restored to my office, and the baker was hanged. Verse 14. Now, for him to even say this is a little scary, and this might have been one of the reasons, I'm speculating, but it's, you know, there's logic to it. One of the reasons he might have decided to put Joseph out of his mind, to forget it, was, you know, you don't want to bring up something that landed you in prison to your employer, especially when he's the king, you know? And it's going to be painful, and kings were not always, like, really reliable and consistent, and it could be an off-with-your-head moment. Like, you brought that up, and, you know, why are you even talking about this? I restored you, off with your head or something. You know, it could be scary even saying it. So maybe one of the reasons he hadn't said something was because, you know, I just don't want to rock the boat here. We're not going to rock this boat on the Nile. I'm just going to move on from this. Maybe not. That's something that I'm thinking, so you might have a better idea. But he does bring it up, so he is risking something here. He is risking something. He says, then Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they quickly brought him out of the pit. And when he had shaved himself and changed his clothes, he came in before Pharaoh. Okay, so there is a huge rush. Why? Because we have the Pharaoh. He's the man. He is the man God, as far as they believe. And you do what he says, and you do it yesterday. And so Pharaoh is desperate. Nobody's helped him. He knows this is a message from the gods. He knows that. And so he is desperate to find out, because these are not dreams with happy endings. So he knows there's something horrible that is supposed to happen, and he doesn't know what it is. So he's desperate. Yeah, let's go get that Hebrew slave that's in prison. Let's just go get him. I mean, can you see how Joseph is like a nothing, a nobody to Pharaoh? But Pharaoh is so desperate that he'll even call for Joseph to come out of there. A Hebrew, not an Egyptian. A slave, you know, no likelihood at all that Joseph would ever go in Pharaoh's court and come before his presence. And a prisoner, you know, he has a lot of strikes against him. And it's only because Pharaoh is desperate that he calls for him. And so when Pharaoh speaks, everybody goes, yes, how high do I jump? And so they rush to the prison, which wasn't that far, and they get Joseph out of there. Now, Joseph's been in prison, and he's also Hebrew. He's Semitic. Semitic people, Semitic men, they didn't cut their beards. They let them grow. They, you know, trimmed their hair, but, you know, it was a sign of manliness. The bigger the beard, the stronger the man. You know, it was a manly thing. But in Egyptian culture, the men shaved themselves. They shaved their faces. They shaved their heads. The Egyptians were fastidious. They were clean. And they thought all that hair was just like a dirty kind of thing. So the men, not the women, but the men shaved. And if they ever did put on hair, it was some kind of royal thing, like a wig or something with crowns and that sort of stuff. And so, you know, Joseph is going to be taken in to the king. You've got to be dressed properly. And, you know, he's been in a prison, in a pit. It's dirty, you know. So he takes a bath, he shaves himself, and he changes his clothes, obviously out of prison garb, into something more suitable for being in a royal court. Now, that wasn't a huge thing, because if you've looked at any ancient Egyptian hieroglyphic pictures or pictures of statues that they've recovered or carvings on the walls, you know that the men that were in Pharaoh's court, and even, you know, most men, they just wore like a white linen skirt that came like to the knee, and they were bare-chested. And Joseph would have shaved that part too if that part was hairy. You just got rid of all that stuff in that time in Egypt. And then there might have been like special collar type of things that they would wear to signify particular status. Like, you've seen pictures of kings, Egyptian kings, that kind of stuff. So I didn't bring it, but I figured most of us have seen stuff like that. So you get the idea. So Joseph puts on fresh, clean linen, you know, wrap kind of thing, skirt type thing, and, you know, sandals, and he's all clean and ready to go, shaved. He's there. I wonder if he's walking in and, you know, he's got a little bleeding cut on his head or something. You know, I think of these things. Like, it was fast. And if you're in a hurry, you know how it is, and you're trying to shave, you could cut yourself. So, I mean, did he have little nicks all over his chin? I don't know. It's just, I imagine these things. So this, by the way, for those of you who just want to note this because you're into that kind of detail, this clue here that Joseph rushes to shave himself and to get dressed to go in before Pharaoh could give us a clue as to the dating of this. And if so, it would be the earlier dating for the story of Joseph instead of the later dating. Because in the earlier dating, we have an Egyptian who is Pharaoh over all of Egypt. In a later dating, we have two pharaohs going on, an Egyptian pharaoh at times in a portion of Egypt, but mostly Egypt is ruled by foreign pharaohs. They were the Hyksos people. Actually, they were Semitic peoples, kind of related to Joseph, to the Hebrews, because they're Semitic. So the Hyksos ruled. And if it had been a Hyksos ruler, they would have sported the full-on beard and the hair, and Joseph wouldn't have had to shave. So there you go. The Bible maybe is indicating that earlier date right there. So verse 15, and Pharaoh said to Joseph, I have had a dream, and there is no one who can interpret it. Now, that's a really big deal for Pharaoh to say, because he should be interpreting this dream. He's the connection with the gods, and he's admitting, I can't do this. Wow. That's a big deal to say when you're supposed to be a god. Yeah, no one can do this. And I've heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. Notice it's you, you, you. That's what Pharaoh, and that's what he's heard, because that's what the cupbearer told him. Joseph answered Pharaoh, it is not in me. In the Hebrew, that's one word, like no. It's not no, but it's like an exclamatory one word that means this, it is not in me. So he makes a big point. Wow, that's kind of gutsy. You're standing before the king of the greatest empire on earth at that time, and you go, no, in a sense, contradicting the king. Wow, God's done more than make Joseph humble. God has made Joseph courageous, hasn't he? God has made Joseph a man in every sense of being empowered and godly and having God work through his life. And so Joseph is able to stand before the king and contradict him. That's huge. That's huge. He says, it is not in me, God. And here again, he uses the article, the God. The God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. Now, the name for God he uses here is Elohim. When it's speaking of, like in the last chapter, God being with Joseph, it's the covenant name of God, because Joseph has that relationship with God. He's talking to a pagan. So he's talking about Elohim, the God, the one and only true above all others God. And isn't this awesome? I mean, Joseph is so courageous. He is so bold. He won't take the credit. He's humble, but he's courageous to contradict the Pharaoh. And then he gives all the credit to God. And that is a picture of how we are to live in this world, in when we are relating with those who don't know Christ around us, or those who have not yet put their trust in Christ. Humble, but bold, and definitely get the spotlight off of me. It's God. It's God. So there you have, you know, you could do a whole study on how to evangelize right there. Just in that statement of Joseph. He says, it's not in me. God will give favor, Pharaoh, a favorable answer. So he gives the credit and the praise to God and says where the interpretation is actually going to come from. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, behold, in my dream, I was standing on the banks of the Nile. Now, he's going to relate his dream. We've already read it. I want you to note if he adds anything to it that wasn't in the account that we already read, okay? So, behold, in my dream, I was standing on the banks of the Nile. Seven cows, plump and attractive, came up out of the Nile and fed in the reed grasses. Seven other cows came up after them, poor and very ugly and thin, such as I had never seen in all the land of Egypt. What's different? I had never seen in all the land of Egypt. Okay, right. And the thin, ugly cows ate up the first seven plump cows. But when they had eaten them, no one could have known that they had eaten them, for they were still as ugly as at the beginning. See, he adds that to it. This is like Pharaoh's commentary. We were given the dream initially. Now we know what Pharaoh's thinking as he saw that dream. So he's like, I've never seen anything like this ever in all of Egypt. Then I awoke. I also saw in my dream seven ears growing on one stalk, full and good. Seven ears, withered, thin, and blighted by the east wind, sprouted after them. And the thin ears swallowed up the seven good ears. And I told it to the magicians, but there was no one who could explain it to me. And when he signals out the magicians, he's really talking about the professional dream interpreters. So he's saying, okay, no one. I don't know, and I'm a god. The gods, you know, obviously are trying to say something, but they weren't very helpful in the dream. And the professional dream interpreters and all the wise men, nobody can tell me what this means. So the added observations, he'd never seen anything like this in Egypt. He didn't know of anything like this of Egypt. And when those thin cows ate the big fat cows, you know, at least when a snake eats something, you see the big bulge. He couldn't even see any difference in them. It's like the previous big cows that were so beautiful were completely gone. And we were still left with these cannibalistic, horrible, skinny, scrawny cows. Ugly. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, verse 25, the dreams of Pharaoh are one. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years, and the seven good ears are 7 years. The dreams are one. Notice he keeps emphasizing. Okay, it's one dream. The seven lean and ugly cows that came up after them are 7 years, and the seven empty ears blighted by the east wind are also 7 years of famine. Now he explains what it is. It is, as I told Pharaoh, God has shown to Pharaoh what he is about to do. And you can add to that, and there is not a god in Egypt who can stop this. That's what's implied by that, okay? God is going to do this. There will come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt. But after them, there will arise 7 years of famine, and all the plenty will be forgotten in the land of Egypt. The famine will consume the land, and the plenty will be unknown in the land by reason of the famine that will follow, for it will be very severe. And the doubling of Pharaoh's dream means that the thing is fixed by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass or bring it about. So, because God gave Pharaoh two dreams, which were actually about one thing, it meant the thing that the dreams were about were absolutely going to happen, and it was going to happen really soon. And God had fixed it, it's going to happen, and there's nothing that anyone and no God in Egypt can do anything about this. It's interesting that the dreams in the entire account of Joseph's story always come in twos. Joseph, when he was 17, had how many dreams? Two dreams. How many dreams were in the prison? Two dreams, one for the butler, one for the baker. And now Pharaoh has two dreams. We see that it is God in each of these saying, I am God, this is happening. So do you think possibly, now we're like stepping outside of interpretation into maybe this could have happened. Do you think, as Joseph is saying, because there are two dreams, it means God has sent it and it's going to happen? Do you think maybe he had a flashback remembering the two dreams that God gave him? Maybe, maybe not, but maybe he did. Maybe he did. Because this interpretation is not Joseph listening to the dreams and figuring them out. God gives him the interpretation at this time. And Joseph himself is learning that because there's two dreams, that God is behind that. And it's absolutely going to happen. That's what he learns as he gives. He is learning this. It's not coming from him. It's coming from God. So as he's speaking it, it's like, oh my goodness, I wonder if it dawns on him. He's thinking, I had two dreams. Does that mean God's behind that and it's absolutely going to happen? I don't know, but it's a possibility. So Joseph emphasizes also two times, verse 25 and verse 28, that God had shown Pharaoh what he was about to do. So the seven-year famine is portrayed by the thin, ugly, scrawny cows eating the fat cows, and also by the seven blighted, thin ears of grain consuming the seven fat, plump, beautiful ears of grain. And this famine is so severe that all the plenty would be forgotten, verse 30, that the famine would consume not just the produce, but the land itself, verse 30. So that's why we have these cannibalistic grains and cannibalistic cows, because it's consuming everything. And that all the plenty would become unknown, verse 31. You couldn't even remember having anything to eat. Now, therefore, and now God gives Joseph the wisdom to say what needs to be done. Because this, you know, I talked a bunch in between this, but the way it should be read is, the doubling of Pharaoh's dream means that the thing is fixed by God, and God will shortly bring it about. Now, therefore, let Pharaoh. So, you know, he's going from interpretation to now wisdom. God is telling Joseph, giving him the wisdom to know what to do about this famine that is coming. Now, therefore, let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over the land of Egypt. Because this just flows from one into the next, this is not Joseph being self-serving. Joseph isn't even thinking that Pharaoh is going to appoint him, okay? He is just moving from interpretation to wisdom and giving counsel from God to Pharaoh what to do. So this is not Joseph being self-serving. It is God using Joseph to tell Pharaoh what he needs to do. So now, therefore, let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh proceed to appoint overseers over the land and take one-fifth of the produce of the land of Egypt during the seven plentiful years. And let them gather all the food of these good years, that's all these overseers, that are coming, and store up grain under the authority of Pharaoh for food in the cities, and let them keep it. That food shall be a reserve for the land against the 7 years of famine that are to occur in the land of Egypt, so that the land may not perish through the famine. So, in other words, a double tithe, 20% of everything that is produced during the 7 years of plenty and abundance, those 7 years of beauty and fatness and plumpness and all this great time, the Pharaoh is to take a 20% of all of that. And he appoints one man to oversee all of that and a bunch of overseers in all the cities to actually do the collecting of all of that. And it's not to be squandered or wasted or sold. It is to be stored for the time that there is going to be a famine. And this is fabulous, because how many of us have a hard time saving? Let's just all raise our hands. A hard time saving for a rainy day, for that what if something happens, for retirement. That'll probably never happen. You know, for these kinds of things, it's hard for us as individuals to do this. So if God is going to save an entire country, and then remember, Egypt is the breadbasket of the world. If God is going to save the world, in a sense, then we need somebody who's going to be in charge of all of this and make sure that it gets saved. That's what's going to happen. And so Pharaoh is going to, you know, put this 20% tax in a way out there. But it's during a time when there's an overabundance. So it's not like everybody's income is decreased by 20%. They're going to have more than 20% extra during these 7 great years. So this isn't a burden on anyone to give this 20%. And it just ensures that everybody will be taken care of when the famine comes, because there would be some people that are really good at saving that would have made it through, but probably the vast majority of people would not have made it through. And then what's to say about all the countries that are surrounding them? If Egypt goes into famine and it has a river, not rain, that determines this, what is the fate of, like, the land of Canaan? That is totally not about rivers. It's about rain and dew and springs. You know, what's going to happen there? It's going to be disastrous in the land of Canaan and the other ancient areas around there and the other kingdoms. So, you know, we've got to take care of Egypt. so that we take care of mankind. And God cares. He cares about this empire that totally doesn't believe in him, that thinks their human king is a god, that worships bazillion gods and gives everything the credit except the true and living God, and yet God cares about them. And he wants to keep them alive, and he wants to preserve them. Do you see the love of God for a fallen world? God loves the world so much, so much. So God not only gives Joseph the interpretation, he gives him the wisdom for the wise plan to save Egypt. And you're going to have to come back next week to find out what happens. You know, you know. God bless you.
Thanks for joining us online to watch one of our messages. I hope it was encouragement to you. Before you click off the tab and continue with your day, I want to invite you to partner with us with your financial blessing and offering and gifts to the Lord. You can find our giving button right above us on the upper right-hand side of the screen. We hope that we're able to continue to bless you in the future. God bless.